Yeah.
Good afternoon, everybody. This is Nicole Hot Mod and
Grant Sparks
from Hot Mod Influencer Agency and from Spark Sites, and this is the Hot Spark Show, and we're super pumped.
Yep.
To have Allison. Did you know Allison before?
I met Allison last year. Yeah.
It's so
great. Like, I love when we get to talk to people like in the influencer industry. We met at the Tampa RV Show last year.
Okay.
In real life, and we.
Built a friendship.
Yeah, totally. Since then. I think we emailed a couple times because I was pitching influencers.
Yeah.
And then we got to meet in real life and like hit it off because she's just such a like down-to-earth person.
Yeah. In the context
Hold
for this.
On. Hot Spark Show.
Oh, Hot Spark Show.
Hello.
Sorry, my bad. Totally missed the whole brand thing going on right there. The context of this is Allison is the influencer and affiliate manager at Camping World. So we're going to learn a lot from her about that. But she's also been at this a long time.
Yep.
And they also have their own handle. I was going to say channel, but they have their own brand, Pine Forest Adventures. I'll get that correct when we bring her on real quick. So they're influencers of their own repute.
Yep.
She's had a ton of experience in this space with affiliates, not
she's
just influencers.
She's an RVer. She's just more like a weekend warrior.
Boom.
Boom.
Boom. Well, let's bring her up without further ado, Allison Fox.
Hey.
What'd you say?
High five.
Yeah.
Here, wait. Go to the side of the screen. Go to the...
Wrong side. I wasn't...
Yeah,
we
wrong
were
side.
All doing it
here,
wrong.
Okay, here we go. Three,
go ahead,
two, one.
What?
There it is.
I like it.
How are you guys doing?
Today, we're doing great.
We're moving and grooving. We created content. Had team meetings.
Yeah.
We just like did all the things.
We had a huddle with our team this morning. We got two other gals with Spark Sites that we're leading and doing a lot of cross-pollination in our companies. What else? We're working on scheduling the next influencer networking event that's going to come up in a little bit.
Awesome.
And we've been working on the influencer toolkit. We should reach out offline about
some
of that.
Yeah, I'd love to see it. I'd love to help.
And with your experience with affiliates, that would be interesting too. And we've got a client that we just signed on that we need to get some details on, but we just signed the contract and they're going to have a big affiliate program. So we should probably cross-pollinate on some of that.
See what's been working for you guys.
Yeah.
It's affiliate is a great way to make some side money as an influencer. People a lot of times think it's just for publishers. It's not. It's for influencers also. So,
they could publish their own affiliate links for their following.
For sure. For sure. If you have a blog, if you have a YouTube, if you have Instagram, you want to put it in your link tree. Absolutely. You want to link to it in your stories. Absolutely. It is a great way to make some money promoting products and brands that you absolutely love.
Right.
Yeah, man. Well, let's start at the top.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. How did you even like get into the RV space and industry? Like, where did it all begin for you?
Oh, gosh. So RVing, I had always wanted to get an RV, and my husband told me no. And our marriage is very 50-50, right? So we both have to be on board for stuff. I don't want to say that, you know, he controlled everything. We had to be 50-50. So I said yes. He said no. There it went. And the pandemic happened, and COVID kind of shut everything down, and we weren't traveling as much. And I, in my old position, one of my influencers happened to be RVers. And I had this 2-hour conversation with her one day. She was walking around, you know, the campsite chatting with me. I was chatting with her and we were chatting about RVs. And she's like, you totally have to do it. You have to do it. You get an RV.
Right.
And that, you know, I kind of got off the phone and she influenced me. And I was like, you know, we really need to get one. And we started with, let's just go get a little travel trailer, tiny little thing. We'll pay cash. It's fine. And we'll pull it behind us. And we went to Camping World to see them. And it just, the travel trailer just wasn't right for our needs.
Yeah. Mm.
From there, we, you know, my husband kind of like panned himself over on the dealership lot and went, I want that. And that was a fifth wheel, a massive house.
Oh, my gosh. He wasn't nervous about towing it right away.
Seriously. And he was like, I want that. And thankfully, it was, you know, 2020, 2021. We couldn't get a truck. It just, there was no trucks to be had.
Like you couldn't go it.
Like, no,
there was a shortage of automobiles for a little while.
It was more expensive than the used fifth wheel. Like that's how crazy it was. And from there I was like, you know, I really want a class A. And he was like, that's nice. And through lots and lots of, you know, dealership visits and waiting for the right one, we got an RV and a Class A. We've got a Tiffin.
Interesting.
Old, you know, 2014. And we travel in the summer. So we're not even weekend warriors, we're summer warriors. We take off for about 8 weeks in the summer and we both can work from the road and we travel. It's awesome. Hey,
you know, I heard a lot of people say that it's better to buy campers, RVs from a certain year back because all the new stuff isn't built as a good quality or is kind of slapped together like compared to some of the older builds. And I don't know if you find that to be true or if you've heard that too, but.
You know, I mean, I've heard that. I don't know. For me, it was just cost. I knew what I wanted and I knew that I couldn't afford a brand new one.
Totally.
So I had to go back in, you know, if we were going to buy a travel trailer, even, you know, some of the newer fifth wheels, we probably could have done that brand new. A Class A, there was no way we could have swung that new.
Yeah, no, it's more expensive.
So, you know, in some respects, the old owners take out the, you know, the issues. They find everything.
Yeah, kind of works.
But it's also RVing, something always goes wrong.
Right. You know? Yeah. There's like
last summer we had a leak with the water that we had to fix. The summer before that we had a problem with the slide. Like it's always something, but that's part of the adventure. That's part of fun. Whether you have a new unit or a used unit, that's part
of it. That is a positive spin on that.
I like that.
And yeah,
I like that vibe.
You hear that from people you talk to. They like, yeah, stuff goes wrong, but if you expect it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And even if you don't expect it, you can roll with the punches and go, such is life and keep going. It's okay. Like we just had the catalytic converter stolen on our Class A.
Oh!
What?
Yeah. $6,500 later.
I was going to say, like, isn't there like a device that, like, isn't there like a clamp thing that goes in that you can protect
it? Which we will have installed now.
That's version 2, Grant.
Right.
Salt in the wound. Now, talking about being resilient and talking about kind of a positive spin on things.
Yeah.
You were telling us just before we got on the call for the public, I'll bring this up to speed, that you were just a stay-at-home mom and you were air quoting because it is noble to be a stay-at-home mom. But you said you had 2 master's degrees.
Yeah.
And I'm like, we can't glaze over that. Like, what are these 2 master's degrees?
So I have a master's degree in essentially organizational development. And then I have another one in entrepreneurship. I have an MBA in entrepreneurship. So
that's huge.
Yeah.
And so then, but you had not worked for anybody right up until ish the pandemic?
Correct. Yeah. I worked in corporate America for tech companies. And then I did a little bit of being an associate professor at a school for, you know, working adults. Loved that. Moved from Arizona to Georgia and pretty much stopped working to have my children, and which I loved. I loved them. All the work that I did over like 15 years was all not paid. So I did work for businesses who did make, you know, money, but I had fun. I was happy to help. I was happy to help out. I had the knowledge and the expertise. Yeah. I could work on my terms. And then the pandemic happened and I was one of the lucky ones who got a job, kind of not meaning to. It just happened.
How did you
end up at Camping World?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the short of the long of it is my daughter got into Boy Scouts when they decided to let girls in and it became Scouts BSA.
Okay.
We took a troop of scouts to scout camp and our girls had to share a campsite with another troop and the other troop kind of monopolized the fire ring. And if you know anything about scouts, at the end of the night, it's really nice to end with a fire, but we didn't have one. So by night 3, I'm sitting in my tent Googling portable fire pits. This is like summer of 2019. And I found Solo Stove and I thought it was a really neat product, but it was really expensive and I didn't want to spend the money. And then I thought, well, you know, for the winter holidays, I'm going to buy one for my husband. And the winter holidays came around and I was like, oh, like $400 fire pit or $10 mug. And he got a $10 mug. And
it was a pandemic after all, very unstable future.
Right. And then, and then the pandemic happened. And for the first, you know, couple weeks, I was really sad and depressed. Like I was missing everything. We didn't know if we were going to live or die, right? We didn't know. We were wiping down groceries. I was missing all of my kids' events because everything was canceled. No gymnastics, no dance, no nothing. And every milestone of things we hit, I got even sadder.
Oh.
And one night I was really upset scrolling social media. And you know the way it is. Like the minute you think something, it appears on your phone.
Yep.
Yeah.
an ad for a Solo Stove popped up. And I was like, this is going to make me happy. And I bought it. news flash, it actually really did make me happy.
Yeah. You can buy happiness in the form of a Solo Stove. Yeah.
A really expensive tin fire pit. But I put a post on social media and they had this program where like, if you told friends and you gave them a coupon, you got points.
Right.
And in 30 days, 30 people ordered off my link. And yes. I got all these points. And I decided, why not? I'm having fun. Like, we would talk at dinner, like, oh my gosh, I got another order. And that, after 30 orders, I reached out to the company and I was like, hey, I don't know if this is good, but like, I got 30 orders. If you want to send me something for free, I will make another post. And they were like, whatever, lady. So they sent me something for free, a little fire pit, and I made another post. And okay. in 3 months, I had 150 orders.
Wow.
Which was really cool. So I ended up getting
connected. What are you doing?
Like, yeah, I like think we need to know this.
Yeah. Talk about, like, there's a secret sauce. Like, there's posting every day where you just like.
There. And all I had was private Facebook. I didn't have any public social media at this time. It was only my private Facebook. But I was utilizing Facebook groups and things like that. So that got the attention of their vice president of brands. She reached out and she said, you know, I'll hire you if you move to Texas. And I was like, I'm not moving to Texas. Can't uproot my family. And I said, look, I don't need to be paid. Like, I'm just having fun. I will continue to help and do. So I would consult on their website, you know, making that better. I was consulting on their program, their reward program, all like they would
Hit the jackpot with you. Not only did you sell their product, but then
wait, you don't have to pay your butt. Okay.
Okay. But this all goes, okay. This all goes
so plan, in 10 months from the time I started, I had 500 orders and they reached out and they said, we'll hire you and you don't have to move to Texas.
Okay.
That's it. So I got hired and I remember being, you know, getting the job offer and saying to my husband, I don't want to do this. Like I was kidding. I don't want to go back to work. And he was like, just try it. Like, you don't like it after 6 months, quit. Like just go try it.
Yeah.
And I was able to revamp their entire influencer and affiliate program. It was very tiny at the time and I was able to grow it very big. Wow. And I did that for 18 months. And after that, I left Solo Stove and came over to Camping World to do the same thing because of my love of RVs. It was pretty seamless. I mean, I love the RV community. I love RVing. And it was a massive fit.
Could we get an idea of what small versus big is? It was small and you helped it grow it pretty big. Like give me an idea.
And you mentioned once before that like this was all affiliate. You didn't pay.
Correct.
Like you didn't need to pay anybody. It was just sending the product and then offering like affiliate.
Correct. Yep. So when I ran it, I didn't have a budget. My budget was I was able to give as much product away as I wanted, but I was not able to pay for content. So what I did is I would give product away to influencers and affiliates who were interested. And then they would go make content and put their affiliate link on their page, whether it be in their stories, their link trees, their YouTube bios, whatever it was. And they would earn commission. At the time, it was a pretty decent percentage. Mm-hmm. That's how they were paid. And and I grew the program to a lot of money. In the millions.
Okay, so the money was in the 7+ figures and that was through affiliates. Now, we have this list of questions, but you girls were talking about something that I think our audience really needs to hear. And if it's okay with you, I'd like to ask this question. You mentioned something that might set some influencers' heads spinning, right? And that is you should be okay doing product deals or barter deals, and though there are very real good reasons to be cash compensation, I want to reopen that dialogue if I could. So was there a story behind this? Did you get pushed back on recently by an influencer who wouldn't do a product deal, or is it just top of mind?
No, I mean, not with us. I had seen something online recently of, you know, somebody saying, remember, you know, we never work for just product trade.
Okay.
And I can see both sides because I'm on both sides. I'm on the corporate side and I hire influencers and that's what I do, but I'm also an influencer myself. And I'll be honest, I'll do almost anything. I mean, I'll do content for product trades as long as it's a product that I like and I believe in and that I want. So some of the most amazing products that I've gotten have been on product trade. Mm-hmm. Happy to get it, happy to use it, happy to give you content in return. So not, you know, especially when you're just starting out. I've been in this business a long time, but our personal accounts have, you know, 2,000 followers. It's not a ton. But taking something that was free, I was able to grow myself from a affiliate perspective as an influencer, but using affiliate links.
Okay.
All the way through now to my second corporate job. So there is benefit. Granted, you know, a lot of people say, oh, I'm working for free. You know, when you're just starting out, sometimes it helps to build you as a person, as a brand, to, you know, your own personal brand to get you experience and to build off that.
Yeah.
So, you know, I my biggest message is don't shut anything down. It's okay to know what you want and stick by that. Full respect.
Yeah.
But don't just shut it down because it's a product trade. It might be a $7,000 product.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It might be a $30 product that you've always wanted to try. And you're like, I'll make a 30-second video to try it. You put that on your organic social. It goes viral. Now you're reaping the benefits. So yeah. Just right. Don't cut anything down.
And always you're like forging a relationship with the brand. And you never know when mm-hmm. a budget will open up. Or if you're, like you were saying, your video goes viral and you've have social proof, then it's possible that they're like, well, maybe you don't have a huge following, but your videos do well. So we want to work with you longer or more or something else. I mean, it just could lead to something great.
For sure. So always be open to all the different opportunities that come your way. Don't put a hard line in the sand and say, I'm not doing it. Listen to what the brand has. And on the flip side, brands should listen to influencers of what they want. And, it's a two-way street. So you always want to meet everybody where they are and then figure out how you can work together.
Yeah, agreed.
What advice do you think you'd give an influencer or a creator who's, I'm sure you see emails all the time. I know she does with her partnership with or her service for Visit Central Florida and her other clients. We see these emails all the time. And I just got a DM from another influencer we met at the RV Creator Show. And they were complaining about how their emails were not being read or any of that. Are you looking for anything specific in your communications? Do you have a rubric at the beginning stages of these contacts?
I don't. No. A lot of times, I'll be honest, again, putting my kind of brand hat on, it's just luck of when you email. Sometimes I don't have any open partnerships, but maybe you email and I just got one today. Mm-hmm. And yours is the first one I read and I'm like, oh, I can gel with this person. Boom, you got it. So some of it is just, it's just luck. Other things is understanding brands, right? So right now I'm a one-woman show at what I do. I have hundreds of emails in my box. And it is just being able to get to and reply to everyone. And sometimes my reply is, I saw it, I'll get to you soon. Sometimes my reply comes 3 weeks later. No fault of anybody's, I just didn't have the bandwidth to get to it.
Right.
So, I heard somebody worry that brands don't like when influencers have Gmails or Yahoo emails versus their, at their brand. I don't know about other brands. I can't speak to that. I can tell you for myself, I've never looked at somebody's email address. I don't care. Just send an email. Like I'm sending that email to me. I'm not looking at what handle it's coming from. I'm just really excited that they thought enough to send the email.
Right.
So I, there's nothing really specific. I think, okay, I'll step back a second. I just want to see, I like to work with genuine folks. People who genuinely also want to work with us.
Genuinely want to work with you.
Right. And so that means like personalizing the email and not sending some generic templated thing where you can tell they're filling stuff in or they're not putting thought into maybe like pitching their like a product that they want to showcase from Camping World or whatever the case is.
And in those generic emails, I mean, sometimes I'll go to their handles and it has nothing to do with the businesses that we do. Nothing at all.
Right.
So where I have 10 others that do. So it's also knowing who you're pitching and understanding why didn't I get an email back? Maybe they knew it was a template. It wasn't the right fit.
We've seen this with campgrounds. And we had a discussion, I forget who we were talking to, where someone applied, an influencer reached out. They didn't speak to seasonality of that campground. They didn't speak to things they'd want to do in the area. They had obviously not done any homework. And so, the email just goes, interesting, archive, it's good. Whereas the gal that did get the brand deal, she had done a little bit of homework. She said, I know you're doing this event, and I think I could deliver a reel like this and a reel like that. I know that it's winter. There was like a series of winter events, and they're like, I could probably interface with some of these winter events. So there was an awareness somewhere of the brand. And so I've heard that for camping grounds that are bit smaller businesses, but I guess bigger brands like Camping World. What are some of those things that they should be looking for with a bigger brand to show that they're familiar with that brand?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think I'm going to step back 1 second. When you email a brand, make it as easy for the brand as possible. So a lot of influencers, a lot of influencers really like to have these media kits, which are awesome and pretty. And they made it in Canva or Photoshop and it's lovely. but I have to open it. I have to download it and I can't click on it. Give me all of your links in your email. Make it easy for me to read. Even if it's a template, I'm going to click on your link and say, who are they? And I'm going to go to their social handles, usually either Instagram or TikTok or one of the two that I click on,
right.
Usually Instagram first. When I click on it, I want to see that you have, for the brands that I work with, maybe not all brands, but I want to see that you have a family-friendly page. Mm. I want to know that I can show my grandmother and my grandfather your page.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to see politics. I don't want to see nudity. I don't want to see curse words for the brands that I work with. So again, and I don't just want to see your kid. I'm a mom. I have my personal stuff to showcase my kids, but I don't want to do that on my personal. If your page is all of your kid, that's great. But how does my brand fit into that as a fire pit brand, as a camping brand, as a backpack brand, whatever it is? If it's a baby brand, then that's different. Know who you're pitching.
Right.
So real talk here. What percent of these applicants are, when you visit their grid, have politics or racy items? Like, what percent would you just guesstimate that is? Over under half.
I like their eyebrows there.
There's a lot. There's a lot. And you'd be surprised. I mean, even from, we get pitched from sports stars. Mm-hmm. And, sometimes sports stars pages aren't clean.
Right. Ooh, yeah.
So it doesn't matter that you have how many followers. If it's not clean, I can't work with you.
Right.
Interesting. So it's not just following size.
Right. It's how, at my last company, Dead Animals was one of them, right? A lot of hunters use the product, but I didn't want to go to a page and see a page of dead animals.
Great.
That you hunt. Kudos to you, but that's not where I want to put the brand. So you have to put yourself in the mind of the brand. What does the brand want to showcase? What is their, how do they want to come across the world? And if you're an influencer for us, how you come across the world speaks to how we come across.
You're an extension of the brand. So when you talk, the content you post becomes,
Yeah. Really, and we were having a very transparent conversation before we got on the call about celebrityhood, if you will, within the influencer space. And it's not just numbers, but there's almost like either you have to have a super strong personal brand as an influencer, or you need to be realistic that you look like everybody else. You act like everybody, you don't stand out, and there's nothing distinct going on here. And so therefore you are an extension of the brand. So are you at least wholesome? Do you how are you presenting here? But a lot of the conversations I'm having, the influencers are scratching their head going, I've got 50,000 followers. Why don't they hire me? And it's like,
There's more to it than that. I still think it's an art. I mean, I really do. You really have to look, and there's more going on below the number game.
For sure. And follower count, unfortunately, these days isn't everything. I mean, it was, I think, 4 years ago and 3 years ago and 2 years ago. Now, not so much, because things are getting so oversaturated. And how do you quantify?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody with 50,000 followers puts a post up. Well, how do I recognize that post drove my sales? Especially from what I do these days, that's really hard. So we're using other ways, whether it be whitelisting, whether it be boosting ads.
Mm-hmm.
Now that means that I don't have to work with just the person who has 50,000 followers who comes to me and says, but I have 50,000 followers, you should work with me. I can now work with the person who has 2,000 followers and says, I've always wanted to work with Camping World. Let me tell you about my family. Or, I've always wanted to work with this. Let me tell you what makes us special. Now I see a real person with a real genuine love. And it's through in their content. I mean, it really, really comes through.
And that's authenticity. We've used this word so much that I don't think people hear it anymore.
Right.
But what you're talking about is what I would say would fall under the umbrella of authenticity. Mm-hmm. And I have a theater background. When someone really believes something, they're like, well, I'm a great actor. I don't have to actually have background. Why do you think so many actors are method actors? They try to go into the thing so that they do develop a genuine love for the thing they're representing. And I think that influencers aren't fully aware that the unseen stuff comes through the camera, whether they like it or not.
It does.
And
I love meeting, I went to the Tampa show and I got to meet a bunch of the influencers in person. And I love that. Like, I love meeting them and seeing really their joy, their family, what makes them click.
Yeah.
That's the best part of my job.
That's the fun part. And I did enjoy that about, you know, this was my first, the event where we met in person, that was my first dip into this particular niche community. And she heard me. I was like, there's like an authentic connectivity that happens off camera here that like any industry should be pretty envious of, because there's this high touch sincerity in most all of the influencers are very sincere.
Very supportive of each other. They want to meet each other. They want to know, they want to learn from each other. I feel like you could just, once you tap into it, you're like, this is.
And, you know, and they comment on their, on each, you know, each of their posts, and they'll comment and they'll like, and that's really fun. I like to get to know everybody. I want to know who you are, what you do. Do you have kids? Are the kids in school? Are they homeschooled? What are they reading? What are they doing? Mm-hmm. Are they raising money for something? You know, where are you traveling next? I want to get to know them on that level.
Yeah.
It just, it makes it so much more fun.
It does. So do you, like, with influencer marketing, it's really like gone into every industry, but how do you think it's affected the RV industry specifically over the past 4 or 5 years from just you being in the industry and like now kind of paving the way for some of these, you know, these partnerships?
Gosh, I think so many more people have gotten into the RV space because of it. I mean, that was the best thing that could have happened to the RV industry was having all of this content go out and people seeing that it is easy. It is easy, whether you are a weekend warrior, whether you're doing it, you know, just in the summer, whether you're full time, there's a space and an RV for everybody. There's a budget, there's a floor plan, there's a class, there's something for everybody in it. And through all of these influencers, they've been able to show a variety of life.
Yeah.
LGBTQ, people of color, young, old, are you from the North? Are you from the South? Families who come over from other countries to RV and travel ours.
Yes.
They're able to see it all through the eyes of the influencers and realize they could do it too.
Yeah, definitely makes you feel like you could get.
Oh yeah, we went and we were like, oh,
you leave there going, I need to get an RV and start traveling.
I need to camp more.
Yeah, I need to camp more. This is it's contagious.
It's very true. Llama Leah says, meeting you in person, Grant and Allison, was the highlight of my week, and I'm always happy to see you, Nicole. I'll be seeing you guys again at RV Creator Yet, which is happening on
February 18th, Camp Margaritaville.
Right in our neighborhood. Wanted to drop a comment and show some love. Definitely. And so, Allison, you met up with Llama, yeah?
I sure did. I did. I got to spend time with her and you know, her husband and dogs, and it was awesome to walk around the Tampa show. And like I said, sounds silly, but in the world that we live in, right, as we're sitting here on the computer, it was nice to just get a hug and say hi.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And let me tell you something. We're talking about authenticity. Leah, if you're still watching, I had a big compliment that I gave Nicole, told Nicole about you. She's one who's very prolific. Like on any given day, she's got like 20 reels or stories, and they're not just reshares, they're stuff she actually makes for her partners, her brand partners. But she really loves it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like she's having a blast. Some people are like, okay, let's put in the time. It's like they're punching a clock at like Flintstone Stone Quarry. They're like, okay, let me go create these brand deals I got to go do because I got a free igloo or something. And then they just pump out a few reels. But Leah was one of those who like, I was like, is she posting another video? She's posting another video. Yeah. But she just brought some authentic energy. Right. To those sorts of things. And I think that's why she continues to get good deals. Go ahead.
For sure. And you know, she was one of the ones where, you know, she had a brand deal for a product and I was like, oh my gosh, that's really cool. I've never seen it. And then that led into, you know, a 15-minute conversation of why this product was so great. She didn't have to. We were just one-on-one. She didn't have to put on anything. She truly believes that the things that she promotes are fabulous.
Yes.
That's what makes it special. And those are the people that brands want to work with.
Yes.
Yeah.
See, that's good to hear. And in a market that's quickly becoming saturated with pseudo influencers, plenty of content creators, the differentiator, I think, is this secret sauce we're talking about. People who are actually in it, people who are niching, but not niching tactically, but niching because of passion.
For sure.
And they're in that, and they're in that sort of thing.
Yeah.
So how is influencer marketing? Your role at your company has largely been influencer and affiliate marketing, but how has it helped shape camping world, if at all?
Again, I think it's just opening us up to new markets. It's been great for people to really see these in action. And now, you know, we're having influencers do tours of different models, which has been incredible. There's only so many tours that we can do. So they're going out and showing it in their own eyes.
Yeah.
So how somebody with kids views a model versus how couples view a model, you know, somebody who's in an older generation versus a younger generation, seeing it through their eyes, and you could look at one unit, right? So you have one unit. If you have five different people toward that unit, they're going to see something else because of what speaks to them. And that's what it's been so great.
That's interesting. I love that. Now, okay, let's talk about you as an influencer yourself. Yeah. It is Pine Forest Adventures?
It is.
Okay.
It is. Yep.
So, like, having had the role you have, do you ever, like, pull up into in these 8 weeks a year you travel, you pull into a space and you start going, okay, I'm going to create some content, and it shapes the experience, like chicken or the egg, you know?
So it's funny. We started this. So everything I've always done on social media has been private. This was the first kind of public four-way that we tried. We were like, you know what? We're going to some really cool places last summer. We're going to start and kind of detail it and try. Just try making content. See what it's like on the other side. Let me tell you, it is not easy. And just to try to figure out what you want to tell, how you want to tell it, to do something every day, it's really, really hard to do that. Mm-hmm. So it was really interesting for me to be on that other side of the content. I wouldn't say that it shapes it, but it definitely gives you a little bit more of a view of things. Is this, you know, like right now, I took a little bit of a social media break around October. Mm-hmm. And I'm just kind of getting back on and getting back into it. And I have that, you know, paralysis of what do I go create? What's interesting? But yet I watch other people's lives and what they do. And then I look at mine and I'm like, well, this could be interesting the way I do this, the way I do that. I cook all the time. We travel. So that's been a really big learning curve for me of everything that we do could be interesting or useful or helpful to someone else.
To someone. We just stumbled on an account, Hubs. And this is the most normal.
Hubs Life.
Go ahead.
Yeah, no, he shows his 9-to-5 job and like coming home. Like it's just like his normal, he's normalizing the normal life. Yeah. And I was entranced. I watched at least like, I kind of binged on his content a little bit. I was like, this guy is really 9-to-5.
But let me give you context. He does not have to anymore. He has almost 700,000 followers on Instagram alone. He edits and literally it's like a down angle of him walking into the office, an angle of him eating tater tots at his keyboard. And it's so normal. And the message of the commenter I was watching was exactly what you said. There is something that connects with some phase of life or some interest that people are in. Now, here's a question about RV life to you as both influencer and marketer in the space. Do you ever find yourself confusing the difference when you talk to a potential person who's like, I want to start in this space, confusing whether or not they're asking you about influence work versus actual RVing, like living the life? Like not every RVer needs to be an RV influencer, right. You know?
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, in my professional life, most people who reach out are influencers of some type or would like to start being an influencer. In my personal life, I've got tons of friends and family who are interested in RVing. So it's how can I steer them, you know, into, you know, come to the dark side, come join us. You know, I there's a weekend trip, you know, with your name on it. Let's go. That's the difference. And some RVers are not influencers, and that's okay. Right. It's, you know, it's knowing what you love and what's going to make you tick.
Yeah, man. Leah follows up and just says, thank you so much. I absolutely love what she does, what I do, and the brands she's worked with are selected with intention. This is our year of intentionality. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I'll never share product, service, or experience that hasn't earned my full stamp of approval. And as the hiring manager for a lot of these influencers, can you tell when someone is literally doesn't care what the product or service is, they're just trying to score the deal?
Yes.
And does it actually matter to you?
Yes.
Does it? Okay.
Sure. I don't want anybody promoting a product that doesn't love it. And even if we know, I've had influencers who don't own RVs, and that's okay, that they're interested, maybe they're shopping for one and want to share that. Great. Like so many people are shopping for one. Let's see that process. I'm good with that. Mm-hmm. So you don't have to always like, you know, ours is such a big product and you don't always have to have it to still be intentional with it.
Yeah, definitely.
Any advice from someone who has had your breadth of experience, both in RVing and in influencer work, like top three tips to someone starting out thinking they're going to get an RVing or shift from their RV life into influencer work? Like what's the top either mistakes or tips when you talk to some of these people?
Okay, so you kind of asked me two different things. You asked and you asked me one about influencers. So keep in mind, you asked
two totally different things. Okay.
For the RV life, I would say just do it. You know, rent one first, see what you like, be able to figure out what class. Because if we had not rented one first, I think we would have gone with something that wasn't right for our family. But we rented something to kind of get the idea first, and then we were able to shape that. Number two on that one is just do it. Like, just go. This country has so much to offer. Mm-hmm. And Canada, right? So many amazing national parks, locations that you would never see if you were just driving from point A to point B, or you were flying from point A to point B. So it's brought our family together. We've made such incredible memories, and I've seen the place dreams are made of. I mean, some of the national parks hold, I will never forget them, and I can't wait to go back. Mm. So that's the RV side. So just do it. Just go get an RV and travel the country. It's if you have it, you can start with something small if that's what's in your budget. But just do it. And you don't have to be full time. You can do it as a weekend warrior or a summer warrior. From an influencer side, it's funny. I'm going to give you the advice that I probably need to hear as an influencer myself.
Okay.
Is just do it. Just get started. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to start small. And it's okay to know what you want, but also to be flexible. Mm. So what do you need to build you as a brand, you as a content creator? And does that mean that sometimes you might be doing, you know, very, very small gigs? Might you be doing things that are just for trade? Sure. Maybe you're doing things that you're not getting paid for at all. Mm. Right. So maybe I'm going to grab here. Maybe you're going to make a video promoting these scissors, but nobody paid you. And that's okay. Let me see how you make content. Mm-hmm. Just because you didn't get paid for this video doesn't mean that you're not going to get either paid or product for another video. Start somewhere.
Interesting. I love it. Any other final questions for Allison?
So good. No, I think we ran through most of them, and I feel like you really spoke to both people.
Well, and what she's saying is you're validating everything we've been screaming from the mountaintops to our clients for like last 2 months.
All I keep saying, Allison, is like, make it easy when you're an influencer and you're emailing someone, you know, brand manager, whatever. It's like, make it easy for them to reach your social links, to reach your channels. Have a media kit that's online. Like, don't you know, don't make it hard. Make it super easy, because then you're more likely to actually read it and
I think one other thing is, when you are coming at it from an influencer and you're contacting a brand, you need to be flexible and understand that folks in my position, we don't have the world open to us. You might want thousands and thousands of dollars and all of this stuff. I don't have it to give you. I wish I did, but budgets, you know, over the past however long have come from, you know, big to tiny, not just me, all over the place. So understand that folks in my position, we want the most for our influencers. We want to fight for you. We want to get you the most, whether it's the best product, whether it's the best opportunities, whether it's the most money. But we don't always have that to give.
Mm. Right.
Know that we are working. We work for our company, but we're also working for you. Mm-hmm. So there's got to be a bit of flexibility to know and only work with folks who are going to do that for you. Right?
Yeah.
So I make sure to take care of everybody that we work with as best that I can. Just be understanding and know that we're doing everything we can for you.
Yeah, agreed.
I love it. So what's the next, in parting thoughts, what's the next adventure for Pine Forest Adventures?
Gosh, so we unfortunately don't have our summer trip planned because... What? I know.
It's almost here.
I know.
No, it's so sad. We've done different pieces of the country in the past 3 summers. This summer, our teenagers have some other things going on that I did not think that we could leave them at home to do for 8 weeks. They're because of internships, they're not able to come with us. So we'll probably be doing some small things. The next adventure is really to fix that catalytic converter. That's kind of key. We'll probably do a small spring break trip. And just looking ahead to 2.5 years when they go to college, and we'll be able to spend months at a time somewhere in the country.
Right. Capture that content on the catalytic converter.
I have it. You have to hear. My husband got in and like turned the engine, and the thing like just roars. I'm going to put it up. It's insane.
Good content. It's good content, man.
But you know, as a creator myself, it's just continuing to figure out what works from a creator standpoint and really immerse myself in that side. I've got the brand side down. It's really trying to figure out what the influencers go through.
Yeah.
Making those brand connections, working with other brands just to have fun, working with other creators. I mean, and meeting everybody. So that's really what's next for us.
Well, Allison, I can't thank you enough for your time. This has been super fun. And I'm glad, I love this aspect that you're not just the corporate side. Yeah. You're an influencer yourself and an RVer yourself. Right. And that's super inspiring. So thank you so much. Yeah, have a great afternoon. You. We'll be talking
to you. Thanks for having me.
Have a great one. Take care.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Takeaways.
She had so much great. I just love that she's given her viewpoint so influencers can see that it's not like a machine in the background who's just like making decisions.
I'm not
like
a corporate greedy guy twisting my mustache going,
I don't even know if they, you know, do they really think that? I don't know. But I know that sometimes you feel like when you email someone and it just falls on deaf ears. And in some cases, maybe. But like Allison, if she's any indication of who's back there or who's on the other end, it's like there's real genuine caring people who understand and like want to work with you. It's just a matter of time and timing.
Time and timing. Yeah. I did hear that. And so to encouragement to any of the influencers who are watching this now or maybe watching the replay, Allison is like a genuine human. And every person we've met in the power position in corporate companies, their hands are tied. We were talking to a campground and there's a gatekeeper and she loved what we had to offer for, you know, we were trying to bring her some influencers and we even finally matched with her needs. But in the end, she's like, I got to talk to the CFO and the CFO hasn't had this conversation. And
there's a lot of layers.
There's a lot of layers, but
cameras.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's a lot of layers. But really, in the end, we're kind of like you, where you might see that this company has a big name and a big brand and understand that it has a big budget at large. That doesn't mean there's a big budget allocated to marketing. Right. That doesn't mean there's a big budget allocated specifically
to
influencer marketing. Right. And so just kindness, I think, is what carries.
I mean, you heard her, like, how she got where she is through service in a lot of ways. And not everybody necessarily has that chance, but she did, and she, you know, used it to eventually earn a job that she wasn't necessarily looking for.
Yeah, man. And it was probably her demeanor, how she carries herself from all these regards.
You can see,
So check them out. Check her out at Pine Forest Adventures. Of course, check out Camping World if you're not already checking it out. You probably are. Next week, we have the illustrious Elise Michaels, who is actually a little deviation from our normal guest.
Yeah.
Men's mental health, but she's going to be speaking, I hope, we talk about her message because it could be a challenging message to put out there, but it's fantastic. She's managed to build a huge following from that. So thank you so much, Allison, for this great day. And to all of those, check in next week, the Hot Spark Show, Thursday at noon.
At noon.
Hot Spark.